Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Thank you very much for keeping it Urban TV. We hope you had a very wonderful Easter holiday, although it came with sad news. Now, for many churchgoers out there, it has been a somber mood following the death of the Archbishop of Kampala Archdiocese, the Right Reverend Dr. Cyprian Kizito Luwanga. And this particular edition of The Checkpoint is dedicated to his legacy and times. On the set tonight, we have a very exciting religious leader who is the youth chaplain for Kampala Archdiocese, Reverend Father Joseph Luzindana. With your permission, allow me welcome you with a fist bump.
Thank you very much, Nick.
Father, welcome to the show. My first question to you is going to be, how are you as religious leaders in the Catholic Church and your laity in Kampala and Uganda, the Catholic Church in general, coping with the demise of Archbishop Luwanga?
Thank you so much, Nicholas, and to all our viewers. Condolences to everyone. I'm sure to all of us it was a very big shock. The Archbishop was not only for Catholics, but he was for the souls, if I can wrap it. I think when we wrap ourselves as souls, then about religion, about, you know, which you belong to where, I think it goes. Let us say the souls. I think he has been serving the souls, and it was such a shock that after seeing him on the television on Friday, Good Friday in the morning, they say he's dead. Even personally, it was a big shock. I never wanted to believe it, though it was real. I think everyone, all the Christians and other people, as human beings, angels are angels and human beings are human beings. As a human being, it has shocked us. We are a little bit down, honestly. But at the same time, we are strengthened by the faith itself. For Jesus died and showed us an example. So you're afraid of death? Let me die first. And then you know. So he rose. And that's what we are celebrating. We know that humanly speaking, it is hurting. It is painful. But interiorly still, we have the faith that is in heaven, and Jesus never left us. He's still with us. The church will continue, though he was a darling to everybody. Yeah.
You mentioned that he was a darling to everybody. I know you're one of the people that have served the longest with him. If I gave you 2 minutes to describe Archbishop Luwanga, the man, the spiritual leader, how would you describe him?
One, he has shown that he gave his life totally to God and the church. He has been working selfless. He really sacrificed everything of his knowledge, his power, his time, his life, his resources, name it, for the sake of the church. He was loving. He was ready to share whatever God gives him. Very hardworking, very developmental, very knowledgeable. He would read and he would write. These two. He would read and write. He knew everything. He would not just come anyhow. He was a very daring person. He would dare anything. He would dare anyone. He would dare any situation, any circumstance, though with great humility inside. So I think he has been, can I say, a multi-purpose person, very talented, very, you just name it. I think a multi-purpose person.
When you talk about him being a passionate reader and writer, I heard somewhere someone say he was a lawyer by profession. Was he? If yes, he was. How does this work? I thought when you are a priest, you are a priest. So how do you then how then does a priest transit to a lawyer, and what kind of lawyer was he? Was he a church lawyer? And how do you attain these qualifications?
The church, the Catholic Church, it's another government within a government. It has the judicial, the judiciary. We have a court. And we have even a Supreme Court where you refer to. Like Lubaga Archdiocese. It is like the High Court here, the Supreme Court here. But it's not yet. Also, if here people are not feeling like they are satisfied, we can appeal now to Rome. We have our own laws, which we call canonical law. Everything we do it within the law. Like if I'm transferred from where I am to another one, they quote for me the law. We have all these laws. Subsection this and this and this. We have all those. So he majored in canon law, though also civil law, this other law, okay. Secular law. So actually the secular law came from the divine law, by the way. So we have also that. And he was, he became a doctor into that. He's a very, very well knowledgeable.
Law.
Yes, law, the church law, and this civil law, the two. So he was really a great knowledgeable person. And he would quote. I think you have been seeing him. He would quote also the constitution. He comes with it on the altar and say, look at this. The police is supposed to do this. Section this and this and this. Look at what they did. So because of that background, he knew. And he would fight for justice. And without fear and favor, like any other lawyer. So I think because of that background also has been giving him a lot of, authority in the way he does things. In his leadership. Also in his guidance, guiding people, and the church definitely. There's somebody who asked me, how does the church also relate with the politics? I said, we work together very, very much.
That's something I
yes,
had on
so
the
because of law and everything, we study. He did not study law as, okay, he majored in that, but every priest, even me, I studied the law. I studied the canon law. It is one of the, we spend a lot of time studying, like after senior six, or you go to a major seminary, the minimum of years you have to spend there before you're ordained, 8 years. That is the minimum. But there are even those who go for 11 years and so. So we study a lot of like leadership, we study a lot of like marriage. We are not married. But I'm telling you, we know, we have researched. I can even tell you so many things. How are you going to guide people when you don't know anything? So we study about culture, we study about politics, we study about, reasoning, like philosophy and logic. And we study a lot of so many, you name it. So we study about the being, how does the world, so many things. We say metaphysics. Is something is really or it is not? How do you prove that? So we don't only go there to pray and be there. Ooh-hoo! We study even what you can study. That's why even now traditionally we go even what happens in the shrine things. We study, my friend. This is African traditional something. We call it Etiara, African traditional religion. So we bring it and we compare. Did really these people mean to serve God or it was the devil? So when we see, I think the Holy Spirit worked in them in their own way. So we bring it like succession in Uganda, what they call Okwabi Olumbe. The Bazungu not going to that. But we have a right here that we have to do that. Why?
Very good. You bring up the point of succession. I without losing it, I want you to help us understand the Catholic Church and cultural traditions. One of the media reports that came up during the last days of Archbishop Lwanga was his family complaining that the church and the people that were in charge of these arrangements virtually snatched the Archbishop from them. They did not allow them carry on their cultural norms and practices. as the Chiganda culture entails. And they are saying this has left a gap because he has been, I would say, a cultural leader as well, being the success of his late father. So how do the two relate, and why did this happen?
My sympathy to the family, even if it was me, and is my uncle, my blah, blah, blah. You know the attachment. Attachment is an attachment. I'm very sure the family had a very special attachment that may be even us who claim we have been with him. I really understand the pain that it caused, and even to the kingdom and to the clan, which he loved so much. But I think the good thing, I was there as well. I went with the body and I came back with it. I knew what happened. I knew what was happening. Mm. Maybe I have to explain a few things. A few things would be like the church. How does the church do? So people appreciate. Mm-hmm. How also the culture, where are the limits? Otherwise, there must be some limits.
Mm. Yes, we need to understand that.
Because some people... We needed to know the limits. Mm. Otherwise, you may misinterpret it. But actually, when the church did something, even which is not done anywhere else, just respect culture. Can you believe? Mm. So if we go with an open heart, we are going to understand. One, time would not allow everything to be done the way people wanted to do it. Like the way he died, time did not allow us to go to take him to hospital, to show him love until he dies. That is how God did it. So everything was like tan, 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 tan. We had reserved this Tuesday to be the body to be taken to Chabakade, people to view. Mm. All right? Mm. But the state also said he has been a great man, a great statesman, and he has really contributed to the citizens of Uganda. The government felt he must also be accorded that honor. And they asked. They only asked even 2 hours. You get me? Mm-hmm. And which the church could not refuse as well. We are also citizens. To be a Christian, not to be religious, does not get you from the duties of Christian, the citizenship. Mm-hmm. So we had to go to Kololoyuso. We had to divide 2 things in 1 day. Can you believe? Mm. So we had to go to Kololo, which almost ended like at 1 or 2. And the state gave us the helicopter at least to rush. So imagine, we should have been there like at 9 in the morning, but it failed. And we had to give a chance to others. We have to be merciful. Sometimes we are too greedy that I don't want food. But we need the state and others wanted to do that. How would you? So let us understand the situation before we conclude. Mm. So we had to go there. We had limited time. One, the helicopter does not travel, does not fly during the night. They can't see. And we did not have any other day. And in the morning, we had to go to Namugongo by 8. You can imagine. So we never wanted. There is a curfew. You can't mock the body of the Archbishop at night simply because we were also caught in between. Now, what happened? The Bishop of Kasana of Lugazi, His Lordship, Bishop Kakoza, received the body and the church of Lugazi, and we went in the church. We prayed, and everybody, we gave them that privilege, and there was no time now to take him to the home. That is one. Now let us go to the limits. Mm. Let us go now to the limits. The church is a church. It has its own way of doing things. You have never seen any priest that when I die, they first take me home, even if I'm the heir, they first take me home, then from there I come back. No. Once you become a priest, you are a property of the church. First of all, we don't bury you to your ancestral place. That is one. Mm. So there are some things that cannot be dictated, that we have to be limited. This is now Catholic Church. Mm. Even the Archbishop to take him to that church, it was just a privilege given to them. I can give you an example. Bishop Okagwa died here just like 3 months ago. Mm. And his home is just on Mitiana, whatever. But he was taken to Masaka. He never even, one hour, she was not taken there. We have seen so many other bishops. When Bishop Chiwanuka died, he died from there, and we prayed from there. He never went back to Masaka. When Cardinal Nsubuga died, he never went back to Mitiana. He was coming. Mm-hmm. So you can see, when the sisters die, they don't first take them to the ancestral. Please, the people understand, the church is a church. It has its own way of doing things. Like the Muslims, when somebody died, they bury that day. And they say, why don't you give us? I say, there is a limit, excuse me. So there is that divine, there is that tradition and whatever. So we could not, honestly, the church may be, I'm not saying it did it from that, but let people appreciate, even to take him to Chavakadi was really a good privilege that was given to all of them to see, to view. So even time, because of COVID and everything, we would not do all the things. You saw in Rubaga, people wanted to come and bury, but we refused them and said, don't come. Namugongo, you saw there were a few people, you can't believe. So circumstances also dictated, but entirely we sympathize with the family. It must be grieving, but we wouldn't go beyond that. If not, the bishop was there, the bishop of, I went with Bishop Sekamanya, Bishop Kakoza was there, and the Vicar General and some others. You think they don't know the culture? They should have allowed. So let us, in God's name, leave it the way it was. And those who say that the government stole the body, I want to clear it. The government has never stolen anybody. Let me clear it. Because he died, the doctors, we have doctors. In Zambia, I mean, Rubaga is our the doctors came in immediately. They took over. They have been with that body. I have been there. He was just in his house and whatever. Now you hear a lot of things the government stole. The government never stole. Actually, the government requested that, can you help us? And we go to work. We are the ones even actually who brought the body to Korolo. We are the, I accompanied the body. I brought it back with others. So I am sorry. I know people don't want us to talk about this. Let the church conclude. Let people begin concluding. We are going to cause a lot of problems. I think, let us say, as Christians say, God, may your will be done. I like the Muslims. For the institution, they say, Isha Allah.
Inshallah.
I think let us go into that.
God, may your will be done. Indeed. And moving on, the demise of Archbishop Lwanga poses then a question. What does it mean in the leadership of the Catholic Church? Because we saw in the Requiem Mass at St. Mary's Cathedral in Lubaga, the Pope Nuncio announcing a caretaker in the names of Bishop Paul Ssemwogerere. And so does that... He's just a caretaker, he's an administrator. So that virtually means there is a vacuum in the leadership of the church. Could you help us understand what this vacuum is and how could it then be filled? Are we waiting for a month to see this vacuum filled? Are we waiting for 2 years? What exactly happens then?
The authority of Jesus Christ, the founder of the church. He's the one who came by the power of the Holy Spirit, was born like any other. He claimed he was the Son of God. He proved that he was until he rose, as he said, and he began this church. So the church, the authority, he gave the authority to Peter and the apostles. To Peter, he said, you are the rock. On this rock, I'm going to build my church. That's why there is nobody who can come and claim this is my church, church of Luzindana, church of anybody. No, not even the church of the Pope. It is the church of God. Now, he gave the powers to Peter. So the successor of Peter who said, I've given you the authority. Whatever you bound on heaven, on earth, it will be bound in heaven. And whatever you unlock, it will be the same. And go and look after my sheep. So that mandate is there. Even when he rose again, Peter had already gone away because of maybe fear that I deny. He said, do you love me more than others? He said, I love you. He said, go and look after my sheep. The second time, do you love me more than others? Go and tend my, look after, tend and feed my lamb. Mm. So, the Pope, the successor of Peter is the Pope. And the successor of the other apostles are the bishops who are looking after the sheep, the followers of Christ. So they have the authority from God to the Pope. The Pope also gives the authority to these ones. And these others, also the bishops, give us also authority. Like me, I get my authority from him. Otherwise, if he puts a signature, it goes. I remain a priest, but with no authority. So that authority, that power to lead must remain there. So the one who has been leading, he is dead. But we cannot lead, even if they haven't appointed the real one now to take over, there must be a caretaker who is now leading. And how does the bishop lead? By foreseeing what is happening, like monitoring, ask the priests and all departments to see that things are working as the Catholic Church does it. So that is his authority. Otherwise, all the departments have remained.
But there have been media reports that, for example, the office of that vicar general, the person that has been occupying it, ceases occupying it until such a time when a new archbishop is
exactly, appointed. Exactly, exactly. So, it is how the church does. Mm. That when you become a bishop, you're going to choose somebody who is your deputy. Mm. But when you die, then what are you deputing now? So it ceases. Mm.
So administratively, which are those offices that have been affected?
Like the vicar general. The vicar general is number two. Mm. He is the assistant of the bishop. Mm. And once he goes, that one goes. Mm. Like you have had like episcopal vicars and so on. Mm. That one now ceases. And some others, a few, not so many, are like maybe the private secretary. You're no longer private secretary. For who? That one goes. A few, but others. The church has its own leadership. It has its organized way. We have departments. Like me, I'm in the department of the youth and the children. Call it a ministry. I'm a minister, or minister, a cabinet minister. So those ones, each one has remained. When we go down to the parish priests, they are still there. When you go to the deans, they are still there. So chaplains, whatever. So every department, every office is still intact. But we need somebody, like if you get sick, we must get, and you have been the one driving the car and you are going to Mbarara. So somebody has to come and take over, but he's not the rightful person. So. Now, Right Reverend Bishop Pose Mwogerere of Kasanalu Well, today now, he's the one now on the steering, but he is not the one the Pope has given to lead this diocese. That's why we call it a seat, that the vacant seat. Where is that seat? When you go to Rubaga, there is a seat where the Archbishop has been sitting when he's saying Mass. That is the seat. It is called a cathedra. It is the seat of the sitting bishop. No one can sit in it. That's why when he died.
So Bishop Semogere cannot.
He cannot. That's okay. even yet, when we were burying, I think you saw, it was there. No one can sit in it. They were sitting on the other side until we get the one who the Pope has given rightly, that you are the one to lead. So you sit in that you have now full authority to lead, to sit and listen and guide and lead. Ingabulawa in Buganda, so you're going to do and take decisions and so on. Now there are some people who are, I'm just caretaking, I'm still doing that, but the rightful person when he comes, I give. So this is what happens, it's called a cathedra. Is the seat, and the church in which it is the cathedral. That's why in every diocese there is only one cathedral. It's like the mother church of all these other churches. Like we have the Vatican. The Pope only sits in that one, so it is the mother of. So, like like the throne on which the Kabaka, the king, sits, until we get another Kabaka in Buganda. No one can sit in it. Even if the Kabaka dies, the Katikkiro will be just caretaking, or anybody, why another Mulangira, I don't know how it is done. But when, until we get another Kabaka, then we put. So
when should we expect another Archbishop?
We expect the Archbishop until the Pope gives us one. So there is no time. It can be tomorrow. It can even take 10 years.
Who qualifies to become an Archbishop?
Any priest that is ordained, he can become an Archbishop.
I thought it's hierarchy, so Archbishop, so bishops are next in queue and then the priests down. Is it possible for an ordinary Father Luzindana to be named Archbishop, yet there are other bishops within Kampala?
Very much. This is leadership. Mm. So the Pope can choose any priest, and then when they choose that one, so he's going to be ordained to become a bishop, and immediately he takes over to be an archbishop.
Okay.
And who is an archbishop?
Yes. Who is an archbishop?
A bishop is a successor of the apostles, to be in the position of the apostles to lead the church. He can be heading a diocese. He can be only assisting another bishop into that, or you can be given any department. And you are ordained a bishop. They can choose from any priest they see that is really capable. They are ordaining you to be a bishop. Now, who is an archbishop? The bishop that leads the diocese is the diocesan bishop, and he has his seat. All right? But the church has the hierarchy that is so great. From the Pope, now is because he's the leader of all the entire world, even in Uganda, he's the one leading the church. So he appoints people to whom they become the bishops, and these bishops are given dioceses to lead. Now, these dioceses, if maybe there are more than one, they come into that family, and it becomes an archdiocese.
But Father, that poses a question. Previously, us while growing up, we knew that the Archbishop of Kampala is the cardinal, the prince of the church. One, I want to understand what's the difference, because we've had the Archbishop of Kampala, we have the Archbishop of Gulu, we have the Archbishop of Mbarara, we have the Archbishop, I think, of either Toro or Fort Poto, I don't know. Previously, we had one Archbishop, and the Archbishop, it so happened that was simultaneously also the cardinal. One, why is it that we have now more than one Archbishop? But also, secondly, what's the difference between the Archbishop and the cardinal?
The church grows. And when every time there is growth, there is also some changes. Are you aware of that?
Okay.
So when you get a lot of money, your diet is going to change, you're going to build another bigger house, and you know. Now, the church also
might afford a court other than just a house. Yes,
exactly. You can have four cars, you know, right. This one go. You know, now the church also grows. For instance, Jesus was in the Nazareth. The only church would think of that of a family of Saint Joseph and Mother Mary and Jesus finished. They did not have any convert. After that, it grew into the apostles. Apostles also, when he died, they went and began preaching, and we had some other churches until Amasa and Mapera came to Uganda, and we had a church in Uganda. So you can imagine, all this is grace. Wherever the church grows, it's going now to share, to divide for easier administration. Now, before, we had fewer dioceses. I can give you an example. We had only one diocese before in Uganda, which was Lubaga. And that Lubaga would stretch from Lubaga, from the Sawaya Queen there, from Lubaga up to Tanzania, up to Kenya. one diocese because there was no diocese. That was where when the Amas and Mapera came, they had to put there the diocese. But there were no parishes, there were no dioceses, so it was one. But it was called a vicariate, Nyanza Vicariate. Then when it grew, they divided in our Uganda into two parts. You see how we are dividing? Now it was one, and it was all in Uganda. Now they divided it into two. They say later the Miruhiru comes, the Miruhiru missionaries. They came and they put the church, the cathedral at Nsambia. So from Nsambia, that was another diocese. But for it, it's going from the Sawaya Queen there, the Nachivubo thing there, to go up to Sudan. Can you believe? So we had now two halves. One from Rubaga, you go and preach going that way down, up to Tanzania and Kenya. You preach going upward up to
South Sudan.
Now, after that, they put another diocese, they put parishes, parishes become dioceses, dioceses now also become together and they become, you know, the archdiocese. Now, before we had fewer dioceses, like in Buganda, we had only Masaka and Kampala, until it grew to Mitiana, to Kasana Luwero, to Lugazi, and now we have five. Now that is already big enough. Now Mbarara has also, we have Mbarara, we have Kasese, we have Fort Potro, we have Hoima, you know, and Mbarara. Also, that is a big thing. Now, to take one Kampala to be now going up to Mbarara, to Goya, to Hoima, then you go to Gulu now. Gulu has Nebbi, Gulu has Lila, Gulu has Kotido, Gulu has Gulu. You get that is also, imagine, that is too much work. We have also in the East, Tororo, we have Moroto, we have Jinja, we have Soroti, you can imagine. So what they did, because the church has grown, so they had to cut it into now, which was two, which was one, it became two. Now after two, now four. What is, we have the East, the North, the West, and the Central. So every time dioceses are more than one, and they come together, even if they're only three, they become an archdiocese. So they get a chairman. Among the bishops of that, and that chairperson, he is the archbishop. And where he sits, it's the archdiocese. That's why it is Archdiocese of Kampala. Yes.
Is it possible for me, we are going for a very short break, but I want you to answer two things before we break. One, is it possible for the Bishop of Nebbi to become an Archbishop of Kampala and for a Bishop of Kasana Luwero to become an Archbishop of Mbarara? That's one. But also secondly, what is the difference between an Archbishop and a Cardinal? You answer whether it's possible for someone from Nebbi to come and lead Kampala, and then we shall resume after the break with the cardinal.
It is very possible, not even in Nebbi, but somebody can come from even in China and is planted here and becomes an archbishop.
With that, let's go for a very short break.